This is the virtual happy hour experience with the Drunken Grape, featuring extraordinary drinks with extraordinary people. I am your host, Rob, and today we have a sensational guest. This man is a mentor of mine. He did a lot for me, bringing me back to the screen and putting me on television and segments. He got the message out for the Drunken Grape. He really helped build this brand. He is a media sensation. I believe his career span really goes back almost three decades. He has been a fixture in the Ottawa and Montreal scenes for morning television, breakfast television, daytime Ottawa. He is a national and international speaker now. He's had TED Talks. We're going to get into this. Ladies and gentlemen, I just want to introduce to you one of my very favorite people out there, the great Derick Fage. Derick, how you doing, bud?
Hey, I'm great, Rob. Thanks so much for having me. So great to see you.
I think it's just wonderful. I you know, we were laughing kind of in the pseudo green room, the Zoom room, about how you normally host things. And now it's kind of interesting to sit on the other end of the table. So, you know, you've had a really storied career. And going into like your past, and you've talked about this with TEDx, I know you're part of an association that helps with a certain health ailment. We can talk about that in a bit in your personal journey. But if I can think of somebody who's really triumphed over adversity that I know very well, your name is at the top of the list. You know, you've taken you know, what a lot of people have had is a insufferable condition and a start to life. And really, and sadly, would have traumatized them. And you know what? Nobody would have faulted them for that. Nobody would have been upset with that. People would have understood it. But you went in the other direction. You cranked the gear towards success, and you've done some tremendous things. So talk to us a little bit about just, you know, your personal journey, how you got started, and how you got to be a household name in much of Canada in show business.
Well, it's interesting. I mean, you mentioned the medical condition. That's an interesting conversation. And, you know, I'll summarize it because we could talk for a long time on it. But, you know, overcoming diversity, so many of us have had to do that throughout life. And so I have a fairly rare medical condition. It's called a high imperforate anus. I was born without the actual anal opening. I was born without a sphincter muscle, which, you know, deemed me living with chronic fecal incontinence. And, you know, it was my parents' problem in the beginning, you know, being born with that, went through many, many surgeries and emergency room visits and so forth. But then, you know, when I got into elementary school, I started to realize I was different from all the other kids. I got picked on relentlessly, bullied relentlessly, both physically and verbally. And so, you know, a lot of challenges as a young person. But I also was a very energetic young person. So my parents were consistently trying to find something for me to release my energy on. And sports was one thing. I was very active in sports. I was probably the smallest kid in every sport I did. But when it came to, I mean, I tried everything. Like I tried out for the basketball team, the rugby team, the football team. You know, I played individual sports like squash and tennis. And, you know, for a kid that was living with incontinence, it probably wasn't the smartest idea. Yeah. But, you know, you want to feel normal. And my parents wanted me to feel that way too. So that was kind of the start of finding an outlet for myself, being, you know, very hyperactive. Although never diagnosed, my mom has always joked that I probably have ADHD and would have been on like the maximum dose of Ritalin if it was so common, you know, when I was a child. And then what I sort of transitioned to was acting and improv. And my parents, you know, to help me with my confidence, I was very confident around friends and family, people that I knew and people that knew my condition. But I wasn't as confident, you know, going to school and being out in public and so forth. So I think, you know, one reason was to get me out of the house and use up some of my energy. And another was to help my self-esteem and confidence. So I took a summer camp, a drama summer camp courses.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And I fell in love with acting. Like I said to myself, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life. And even as a young person, that was my dream. I wanted to act in film and television. I wanted to be in comedies and I wanted to be in action films. That was my dream.
That's really cool. That, you know, wow. And it's, you know, you definitely have some energy. I mean, you've got this youthful vibrancy of a man that's, you know, quite a few years younger. You got the surfer look going on right now. I love it, by the way.
It's the COVID look, my friend.
But it suits you. Like, I'm used to seeing short cropped hair and a suit on set, but this looks great. And, you know, that personality of yours is just magnetic. And I think this came from being a child and really having to fight over these things. And this is where a lot of things start for a lot of people. You're not alone. I listen to a lot of really successful people have made a lot of their situations. And it's a very common theme that they had to cross a major hurdle. It's almost like that hurdle was a rite of passage to become something much greater.
Yeah, you see a lot of people in the entertainment industry that have suffered through tragedies in their lifetime and gone through challenges. And I think it's something that naturally just ends up coming out of you as wanting to be, you want to be heard. And I think you know, you want the attention, you want to be loved because you've gone through such incredible obstacles. And then, you know, for me getting into television, I kind of fell into it. So, you know, throughout high school, I was in, you know, I was on the assembly committee, I was on the improv team and that kind of thing. And then when I left high school, I started working for my dad's computer consulting firm. We happened to have a computer when we were probably one of the first people in our neighborhood that had a computer. We had an Apple II Plus. And my dad always loved technology. So we had one. So my brother and I were very fortunate to learn very quickly how to use computers. And that, you know, we're going back 40 years now. And, you know, that the computers back then were not what we see today.
No, and not at all.
So I had an advantage. So, you know, one of the guys at my, it was called Electrodata, and he sort of reached out and said, hey, you know what, are you looking for a summer job? I'm going to be doing some training of some salespeople downtown at an office equipment store. And I know that you have some computer background, and I'd love to teach you the software. And therefore you could go and help us, you know, help us train these people. And I did. And then I ended up working in my dad's accounting firm. So I kind of left the acting world. It was still an absolute passion, but the reality of, you know, paying rent and putting food on the table all of a sudden creeps up on you. And, I did that for quite some time. And then all of a sudden I started regaining that passion. My ex-mother-in-law at the time saw an ad in the paper for murder mystery dinner theater. And she knew that.
I remember those.
Yeah. Yeah. And so she said, you know, this is something you've always talked about. You love acting. Why don't you audition? I did. The company's called Big Time Murder Productions, still around. They're doing virtual shows now. I was with them for 7 years. Had a fantastic time, traveled internationally with them, did a lot of corporate Christmas parties and so forth. So that sort of rekindled my love of acting. And then I started doing, you know, some local movies, some local commercials. And then the audition for Daytime came my way. And my stepmother saw the ad in the paper and she said, hey, look at this. Yeah, she said, look at this. Or look at that. You'd be great at this. You should audition. I was like, I've only got a few days. I don't have a camera. And she's like, listen, your father will borrow a camera. You're going to do an audition. Just get a friend over. So I did. My friend Jamie Douglas came over to my dad's place. And my dad recorded me interviewing Jamie. I sent it into Rogers TV and I heard from them fairly quickly after and said, hey, you know, we loved your audition. Come on in and we'd like to do an audition in studio. And I did. And it happened relatively quickly for me, Rob. They ended up having a competition. So there was five of us. I was competing against four other people.
Wow.
It was exciting because they had ads in the paper, vote for the new host of Daytime Ottawa. And they had an online voting system. So at the end of the day, management was going to make the final decision, but they gave you know, viewers an opportunity to vote. And I ended up actually getting the most votes. And, you know, I ended up with the job. I didn't even know if it was a paying job, quite frankly.
Wow.
I was just excited. And then I found out when I got the job that it actually did pay. And it was a whirlwind. And I soon found out that although I always wanted to be an actor, I loved the idea that somebody had hired me just to be me, right? That's all they wanted from me. Derick, you know, we like your personality. We want you to be you. You're curious by nature. You love people. we think it's a great match for you. And that was back in 2004. And I did that for 11 years. And I hosted and produced the show on my own for the last 2 years.
Yeah, no, I remember when I first came on the set, you were just busy. And, you know, for the viewers tuning in and watching this, this isn't a facade. This is exactly how Derick is. This is exactly your personality. Like, it's consistent. I remember when I first walked in the green room, it's like, hey, you're the wine guy. What's going on? I like you right away. And I just was a captivating, like, you pulled me right in immediately. And I was like, wow, this is going to be a lot easier than I thought, just because of the energy of your hosting capability. And you got to think, you did this day in and day out, 11 years.
Yeah.
Like, that's a change of personalities. That's a change of staff. That's a change of script. Every day is a totally different show. And you've got to make this tick on the fly because, you know, some guests are great. Some are duds. This is just show business. It happens. It's a live format. Yet you kept it ticking where you became a household name in Ottawa. People tuned into this. They watched this. And then you were sought after. It wasn't like you had to look around for other exterior opportunities. I mean, you got to host Ringside for Youth. You were brought in to be an MC at numerous events. You know, I remember back in my hotel career, I would be behind the bar and I'd pop up and I'd there's Derick Fage. Sure enough, talking to 1,000 people at a gala right there in front of me, or in the Shaw Center, where it's a much bigger operation. You'd be talking in front of thousands upon thousands of people. And your ability to improvise, and I think this comes from the acting background, the fact that theatrics sat in you as a child. My late twin sister had the same type of personality that way. She loved drama too. And you could see that they can just, it could animate something in a second. And it's a gift. And, you know, you think of show business, it's not like the wine business that's a trade. You know, there's a million good job opportunities in wine business. Does the ceiling of pay is probably not nearly as high as show business, but it's a much easier, it's like any traditional trade or industry. If you work, you get the certifications and skill sets. It's an easier industry to just transition into. The entertainment business, I was involved a bit of that in the cruise line industry as an assistant cruise director. And on Renaissance Cruises, we had one guy who was a known British comedian. I can't remember his name anymore. I don't even know he's with us anymore. He was probably in his 60s then, and we're going back 20 years ago. But he said, he asked me, he goes, you know what the average pay rate is in the world for our actors and actresses and show business people and hostesses? And I said, no, what is it? It's about $6,000 a year. You can actually look it up. And I'm like, wow. So anyone who was able to make a springboard and get into something gainful, which you did for 11 years, then you have this awesome opportunity to come along at Breakfast Television. What a great journey that must have been. Talk to us a bit about that. You transitioned from, you know, Ottawa's not a small city. It's a decent sized city. It's about 1.5 million people in the region now. This was your reach daily. Yeah. And you went to a city where now you're in front of a reach of 5 or 6 million with the whole metropolitan area. I mean, this whole ballgame just changed. How was your time there?
It was great. I mean, it was a bittersweet end, and I'll get to that in a minute, Rob. But that was, you know, that came out about, they just sort of reached out to me when one of the hosts was taking vacation, and unfortunately, one of the hosts lost her mother unexpectedly. And so they were looking, and they were looking for somebody to fill in. So they reached out to me and asked me if I was interested in filling in. And I did, I filled in for about 3 weeks time. And the crew there was wonderful. The on-air personalities were amazing.
Yeah, great cast. I saw some of the shows and it's like, you fit right in though. This was the crazy part. Like, this is skill. This is ability. It's like, you're an athlete. You just got transferred to another team.
I'd also put it at being easy to work with. And I think that's incredibly important no matter what industry you're in.
Agreed.
You know, the media industry is a different animal for sure. There can be big egos involved.
Oh, yeah.
You know, you're talking about ratings. There's a lot of pressure. There's an incredible amount of pressure on people that are in the industry. And I think there's a lot of anxiety because they see how much turnover there is. There's a lot of constant turnover in media in television and in radio. So there's a sense of anxiety constantly sort of in the back of people's minds of, you know, I hope I can continue to do this. So after I had done that, they reached out and asked me if I would be interested in taking the job full time. That was a tough decision, Rob, because Ottawa is my home.
Yeah, you were loved. You're loved in this. You're still adored in this community. I mean, when you came back, it was almost like a massive applause on social media with the announcement that you were coming home. And, you know, the outpour of love to you was tremendous. I just saw this all over my Facebook feed. Derick's back. Yay. You know, it's like this excitement. You know, even Dylan, and he took over and he did a great job taking over the show. And Amazing job. Just really happy to see you come back too. He's just like, wow, you know, my friend's back. You know, you came back home.
It was difficult and a challenge because my family remained here in Ottawa. So my wife and my daughter and my stepson remained in Ottawa, you know, for various reasons. My wife has a good job in the federal government. It's not something she could just get up and leave. We also and we have children from previous relationships that we have shared custody with. So it wasn't one of these family dynamics where, hey, Derick got a great job and we can pack up and move to Montreal and it's an exciting city. And, you know, we're going to start this new adventure. So I was commuting back and forth between Ottawa and Montreal every weekend. So after the show on Fridays, you know, we'd have our meetings after the show. I'd answer, you know, a few emails and so forth, jump in the car, come back to Ottawa, spend the weekend with my family. After dinner on Sunday, I would head back to Montreal. And that was tough on not only my family relationships, but it was tough on my friend relationships, my social relationships.
Sure.
I had built so many wonderful relationships in Ottawa. I was also happy with the fact that I still had the connection to Ottawa. You know, and then Mark Sutcliffe gave me a call and asked me if I'd be part of, you know, the Power Lunch every Friday on City News here. So I remained that connection, and that was incredibly important for me because it was lonely, Rob. You know, I was by myself in a new city for 4 years. Great opportunity, but, you know, sort of a lonely existence, to be honest with you.
Yeah, I can relate to that. You know, on ships, every time you're gone for months on end, you're in some far corner of the earth, and you get to know some shipmates from different lines over time, and you make your friends. It's like show business. You know, there's probably a couple people in there that you recognized. I mean, it just comes along, but it is unsettling. And then, you know, I was a single man. I mean, that's a different story. You're up seating a family, and I know the family is really tight for you. It's one thing I've always known too. Your wife's a terrific lady. I'm always happy when I see her. She's such a nice and warm and engaging personality. And I know that family is like a very, very, as well as for me, it's integral in our lives. I mean, your friends and family are, you know, your friends are the family you got to pick. And then you got your core family. And it's true to be gone like that. And then that 2-hour commute back on a Friday, busy day, you know, people forget, and people watching this, you may not realize this, but if you're on for an hour of television, in that case, Breakfast TV, I think ran 4 hours every morning. It's a long program. That means usually about 10 hours a day of work for prep time, cool down time, and getting ready for the next show. And it sounds briefings.
And it looks glamorous, Rob. And it is a lot of fun.
No, but it's not. Know, it is.
Yeah. It's like a dream job, right? And to go from doing a 1-hour live show to doing, and, you know, again, you know, I had a rotating guest co-hosts each and every week, which was wonderful. I was also booking 35 guests a week on my own, you know, so to go to an environment like that and to a 3-hour show where you have three other on-air personalities with you, where you have a larger team behind you. You know, you have multiple producers that are working on booking guests for the show. It certainly made life easier. And it was a new experience, Rob, right? I went from kind of a lifestyle show to a newswheel show, right? Where we still had fun and engaging guests and, you know, still got to feed that curiosity that I loved. You know, we still did food and fashion and things like that, but we talked about serious news items. We, you know, had your weather and traffic updates. We had, you know, Elias Makos that was talking about what's trending on social media, and he would engage my co-host Joanne and I, and then the four of us would get together and have chats about serious issues that were happening either, you know, locally, nationally, or globally. So all of a sudden, you know, it's a whole new learning experience for me, as much experience as I had doing daytime. I would say for that first 6 months, I was in learning mode. And you mentioned all the time that you put in. Yeah, I was putting in long, long hours in preparation. It got easier, certainly. I wasn't working 12 to 14 hours. You know, after about 6 months, I could rein that into about, 8 to 10 hours a day. But the day never ends, because you have to keep up to date on what's happening in the world. You know, and I'm filling in for the Rob Snow show at this moment, and he's taking vacation, and that's the same kind of prep, right? After I leave the station, the producer David and I were still looking at what's happening in the world, both locally and nationally and internationally, to see what are we going to talk about tomorrow that's going to be timely. So there's an incredible amount of preparation.
Yeah, it's intense, and personalities too. It's weird because we talked about hospitality and its difficulty trying to retain staff and show business, losing staff. Yeah. And, that seems like the media companies are going in the wrong direction. Instead of bolstering these personalities, they're cutting them. You know, stations are cutting down time. What they should do is be hitting the switch on the virtual, the internet side, and really getting good cast members in. This is my vision for it. And it's just, get rid of the narcissism that sits in it, because that's a big part of the problem too. And it's funny, because these are some of the industries where you want to have people at their happiest, you want them at their most jovial. So why are you taking the screws and doing this to them instead? It just, to me, it's an illogical way of thinking. And we also talked, we were talking just before the start of this about the pandemic. And one great thing I think the pandemic has done is it's woken people's eyes up to things that do need to change across the board. And people aren't settling, and they're not settling anymore like they once did.
Yeah, and that's interesting you say that, Rob, because even on the other side of the coin, you talk about the media giants and so forth, but you also have to realize that narcissism and those big egos are also the on-air, it can be the on-air personalities. I'm not painting a broad brush here. There are so many fantastic people, but we're now in a situation where there are so few jobs, we don't have to hire in this industry jerks. We don't have to do it. We don't have to put up with rude behavior from people. We don't have to put up with people that think they're above the crew members that are working on a particular show, that you're the entire show. We're not. We are not the entire show. And you mentioned, on-air personalities and how many people come and go. I'm telling you, behind the scenes, Rob, the amount of people that have been let go.
It's nuts.
It's so much, talent,
much talent. You can't just bleed this talent off and replace it overnight.
And people sympathize with on-air people when they get let go because they have a connection. But the people behind the scenes that have been let go and are trying to, and you know what? They're doing things like you're doing as well. Let's not forget. We also have, social media, and we have technology now, which you see a lot of people doing it for themselves and turning themselves into celebrities, right?
Yeah, it's true.
There's a place for local television, though. There's a place for local radio, because whenever we do surveys, I don't care which company you are, but I can speak as far as, working with Rogers. Whenever we do surveys, what are people telling us? They're telling us that they want local television, local radio, local news. They want to know what's happening in their community. And the one thing I will do is if you feel that way, encourage you then to watch local television and to listen to local radio, or it will be gone. And you're going to be missing a big, big part of your lives, because, when you look at the most important things in your life, especially you and I have talked about government.
It's local.
When it comes to a municipal vote and election, we should have higher numbers for that than provincial and federal election, because that affects you more than those other things, right?
And speaking of local, the happy hour toast is here. I don't know if you got anything here, but this is Ladybug. This is by Malavoir. Oh, cheers, brother. What are you drinking?
Cheers. This is vodka cream.
There you go. Vodka cream.
From the dairy distillery in Almont.
How is it? That's an interesting brew or beverage you got in your hand.
It is fantastic. They also do their Vodkow vodka. They had an amazing story during the pandemic. They actually started producing hand sanitizer because we were in such a desperate situation, and they were delivering hand sanitizer to the Ottawa hospital. And wow. So it was, oh yeah.
Yeah, in the beginning, I remember that.
Yeah, it was an amazing story. And so they still make great stuff. You can go and visit them in Almont. Their distillery is there, and it's available in the LCBO. And it's fantastic, especially around the holidays.
That's cool. And you know what? You can almost add just a bit of Kahlua in that. You'd automatically have your white Russian in your hand.
You got that right. Yeah.
That's awesome.
Absolutely.
So this is Malvoir. It's an Ontario wine, Niagara winery. Rosé is a great wine to have at this time of year. It's hot outside. It's steaming hot in Ottawa this week. This is a great wine. You can have it nice and cold. It's got strawberry notes to it. I found the body was nice. It's a mid-bodied wine for this type of wine. It's dry with a little bit of sweetness, which kind of rounds it out nicely.
Nice.
It's got some nice acidity to it. You know, this is great for the barbecue. I think of having this with charcuterie, for instance, or a cheese and meat board.
For
you
sure.
You can have it with your barbecued pork. Salmon and trout. What a great thing to have in the summertime. This is just a great pairing. So and cheers, Rob, my friend.
Cheers. I was going to say too, and rosés have come a long way, right?
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Like you go back 15 years ago, you offer someone a rosé, they're like, yeah, no, I'm good. But there's so many different varieties available now. They've really come a long way over the last few years. So cheers.
Yeah. Cheers, man. And especially here in Ottawa or in Ontario. That's a nice wine. Rosé is one of those things that has always been respected in Europe. But, you know, our budding wine scene didn't really take off until the 80s in this province.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you're right. I mean, it was really till about the year 2000. Nobody talked about local rosé wine.
No.
And, I mean, this one actually is named from the ladybug, the Asian ladybug infestation.
Oh, yes. I've had it. Now that you show me the label.
This is a great wine. It's like $16 at the LCBO. And, you know, that's the other thing, too, is local. Support your local community first. And you nailed it by saying, get out in the municipal election. Turn on local television. You're going to want to know what's going on in your own backyard. Too much of us have this bad habit of turning on national television or international television. And then we're just hearing the horror stories of doom and gloom right away. It's like, if you really want to ruin your day, start off with that. Whereas if you go to local news and you turn it on, it's generally a lot more exciting stuff. It's more positive.
Yeah, for sure. There's a lot more positive stories as well. You know, people are sharing stories of these fantastic trailblazers in our community. They're highlighting great artists in your community. They're sharing success stories. You know, even during the pandemic, there's still been success stories. There's still been businesses in our community that have had great success over the pandemic. And, you know, it's not taking away from any of the businesses that have been suffering, because there's a lot more that have been suffering than successful.
Yeah.
But the local television and local radio, they have the opportunity to do that. And I will also say, you know, it's not like you're going to miss out on the national and global news. That's important. You know, that's important for people to realize, because Canadians are great in that manner, where we do think outside of our borders. We're not a selfish country where we think, you know,
we're not.
We only want to know what's happening here in Canada, and, you know, too bad what's happening for the rest of the world. They can deal with it. We are very understanding, and I think we're a very global community here in Canada.
Yeah, and that's a big plus to be Canadian. Without a question, I would never want to lose that identity as being a Canadian. I think that also you just hammered straight home. I couldn't have put it more accurately. That's just 100% right. It's just one of our prideful things when you see that flag, you know, and it's like, woo-hoo! And it's really cool. Well, listen, you've been a great guest, you know, happy hour to everybody watching this, wherever you are. Make sure to enjoy the happy hour experience. Obviously make sure to watch this, like this, share this channel, subscribe to the channel. Reach out to us. I'll have the show notes in the bottom. I'll have details of how you can reach out with Derick, what he's currently doing as he resurrects or revitalizes much of his career in show business. He is not alone. Lots of things have been rattled in this pandemic. But there's one thing for sure with you, Derick. I'm 100% confident you're going to end up on top, because you always do.
Thank you so much, Rob. Appreciate you spending time with me. And it's nice to be interviewed for a change. Cheers, my friend.
Yes. Much love, ladies and gentlemen. Listen, this has been a great show. Extraordinary drinks with extraordinary people. Wherever you decide, whatever you decide to do, ladies and gentlemen, have a terrific day. Make the most of it. Seize the moment, or carpe diem, as we like to say. This is Rob from the Drunken Grape.